Hello everybody and welcome back to the Tomb Raider Underworld walkthrough. Now you may be looking at this part and thinking, oh my good god, that is long. And yes, it is long, but there is a very specific reason for that. Basically, we are going to be covering the end of our time on Yan Mayen Island, but we are also going to be visiting the Andaman Sea. Yep, we are covering one and a half, really, chapters, levels, in this part alone. The reason for that being that level 6, which is in the Andaman Sea, is really incredibly short. Like, about maybe 7 minutes or so, and really, as nice as it would be to just have a lovely 7 minute long part, just feels a bit like a waste of space, really, just to have that on its own, when there has been absolutely no precedent for parts being that short. I mean, I don't want to cheat you out of stuff or anything, because, or make, like, force you to just sit through a really diddy part. I may or may not be doing that in my next playthrough, but there's more reasoning behind that, whereas here, it's a full level. Might as well just do it. But either way, as you can see, there's a lot of massive hammers here, and also this thrall isn't coming down after us. There is a very good reason for that. It's because he's connected to a cutscene that we will be instigating right about now. But, oh good grief. This room is nuts. Absolutely well and truly nuts. Now we have a very quick adrenaline moment there, and then it's sort of a race to safe ground. It's not quite a race you want under any strict time limit or anything, but there are certain bits that will crumble beneath your hands if you aren't careful, so you've got to be just about on it. I believe it may be, I thought it might be that ledge or something. I can't really remember anymore, but either way, there is a massive spider. Thankfully, you can shoot from the this sticky outy poly thing. But obviously, you've got to be just about careful on your balance. I'm quite grateful, though, that the spider doesn't attack you at this point in time. There will come a moment where it will, but that time isn't now. Anyway, seeing as we've just got to make our way through here, and there's a ridiculous amount of hammers about, I should probably have a little talk about what we're here for. So, as has been stated many, many times before, we're after Thor's hammer, which is Mjolnir. You can tell that we're after the hammer because, well, one, that's what Lara has said numerous times, and what I've said numerous times, but also because there are a bunch of massive flying hammers everywhere that are trying to kill you. Now, Mjolnir, I mean, it's a pretty awesome name. Apparently in Old Norse it means that which marks and pulverizes to dust. Which is a pretty nice name. So, basically it's because Mjol in modern Norwegian literally means flour or powder. So, Mjolnir, which would be Norwegian spelling, can mean pulverizer. apparently it's usually interpreted as meaning that which smashes. So the term molva, to smash, which is comparable with the roots which mean hammer, so Slavic molot and Latin malleus. So that might be how that kind of originated. An alternate suggestion compares the name to a Russian word which is molnya, and the Welsh melt, both words which are taken to mean lightning. The second theory would make Mjolnir the weapon of the storm god identified with lightning, which makes sense. But also in Old Norse texts, Mjolnir is identified as hammer, so a hammer. A word that in Old Norse and some modern Norwegian dialects can mean hammer as well as stone, rock, cliff, etc. And it's, yeah, it's kind of cool. Now there's apparently a whole wonderful story about it. Mainly in the account of Norse mythology, it's related how the hammer was made by the dwarven brothers Sindri and Broka. And basically it's got a characteristically short handle, which is due to the fact that there was a mishap during its manufacture, because of course. So in the Edda, Loki bets his head with Sindri and his brother Broka that they could never succeed in making items more beautiful than those of the sons of Ivaldi, who are the dwarves who created other precious items for the gods, i.e. Odin's spear Gungnir and Freya's colorful boat Skithblathnir, something along those lines. So Sindri and Broka accept Loki's bet, and the two brothers begin working. They begin to work in the workshop. Sindri puts a pigskin in the forge and tells his brother never to stop working the bellows until he comes and takes out what he put in. Then Loki, as a fly, comes in, bites Broka on the arm, but he continues to pump the bellows. Then Sindri takes out Gullinbursti, which is, I think, another version of, well, oh no, it's Freya's boar with shining bristles. Then he puts some gold in the forge and gives Broka the same order. Again, Loki, still in the guise of a fly, comes again and again, bites Broka's neck twice as hard as he bit in his arm, but Broka continues to work despite the pain. When Sindri returns, he takes out Draupnir, which is Odin's ring, which drops 8 duplicates of itself every ninth night. Finally, Sindri puts some iron in the forge and tells Broka not to stop pumping the bellows. Loki comes a third time and bites Broka on the eyelid even harder. The bite is so deep that it draws blood. Blood runs into Broka's eyes and forces him to stop working the bellows just long enough to wipe his eyes. Then, when Sindri returns, he takes Mjolnir out of the forge. The handle is shorter than Sindri had planned, and so the hammer could only be wielded with one hand. But despite the flaw in the handle, Sindri and Broka win the bet and go to take Loki's head. However, Loki worms his way out of the bet by pointing out that the dwarves would need to cut his neck in order to remove his head, but Loki's neck was not part of the deal. And so, as a consolation prize, Broka sews Loki's mouth shut to teach him a lesson. And then the final product is presented to Thor, and its properties are described as follows. Then he gave the hammer to Thor, and said that Thor might smite as hard as he desired, whatsoever might be before him, and the hammer would not fail. And if he threw it at anything, it would never miss, and never fly so far as not to return to his hand. And if he desired, he might keep it in his sark. It was so small, that indeed it was flaw in the hammer that the forehaft was somewhat short. So, all I can say, thank God for Wikipedia. But basically, Mjolnir is kind of the focus of a lot of stuff to do with Thor, as I believe I said when we were talking about the belt and the gloves. I think it's basically because, as I said, weapons slightly more interesting than gloves and belts and so on and so forth. but what's pretty cool is that there are, well, there's numerous depictions of it. But what's rather odd is that, so everybody knows about the swastika, largely because, well, everyone knows about the swastika because of the Nazis. Now, you may think, oh dear, this is going to be a very, very, very serious discussion. No, it's not, because, as I'm sure, well, hope a lot of you are aware, the swastika symbol existed long before they ever took hold of it. And it used to be, well, I mean, I think it still is considered to be very sacred and auspicious in Hinduism, Buddhism. I think it's also in Japanese as well. And it means, I think it means peace. Unfortunately, obviously, things changed. But what is important is that the swastika may or may not have been a symbol for the Hammer of Thor in some form. Because basically, there is a sword. It's the something like the Sabo sword, but it's also known as the Thirmuth sword, which is an early 9th century Viking sword that was found in Norway. And what's very interesting about it is that it's got runic inscriptions along its blade, which is very, very rare. But it has a swastika symbol incorporated on it. Now, apparently, well, there was a guy called George Stevens, who was an English archaeologist and philologist, who specialised in runic inscriptions of Scandinavia. And he describes the sword in 1867. And basically, he showed a drawing of the sword which had a very clear inscription, which, it had five runes or rune-like letters with a swastika symbol in the middle. Now, what Stephen stated was that the inscription reads, "O swastika, moo, and then a thorn from right to left." And he interpreted the swastika as being sort of a symbolic way of representing the syllable thur, so thorn you are. So that would be for the god Thor. And so he expanded the reading to O Thirmuth, which means owns me Thirmuth. So basically, that type of reading was inspired by the fact, well, at least the idea that the swastika was used as a symbol of Thor in kind of Viking Age Norse paganism. And it was kind of commonly discussed, because there was the prevalent opinion that the swastika stood for blessing or good luck and all those sorts of positive messages. Unfortunately, the blade is pretty much now indecipherable because it was treated by acid, but that whole idea is quite useful, because it may very well be that that was the case. Obviously, there is the potential that it might not be quite correct, but it is there. However, it should be noted that quite a few faiths wear Mjolnir pendants as a symbol of their faith, so it's mostly Germanic neo-pagan faiths that wear it. So there are kind of numerous designs of it. But yeah, it's just quite cool. Now, I will say I am not quite a huge fan of this area. I mean, it's cool and all. It's just that sometimes it's a little bit dodgy to jump over the grinding thingies. And also, jumping onto these damn hammers is a really awkward issue of timing. Like, I mean, it's not necessarily ridiculously hard, but it's still quite a bit of a pain. But I believe that might be through this particular hole once we get to the bottom. Or not this room at all. I believe it's the next room on the other side, which has all the mechanisms. We'll be coming across something that's rather terrifying. Like, really seriously terrifying. Now, as I believe you can just about see, there's a lovely artifact treasure thing just sitting there for us. And we are going to be getting it, I think. But it's... it's a little bit stressful to try and get it, because you are sitting above this massive pool of Aetir, which is just like, oh my god. And rather irritatingly, the grappling hook wall run technique is a little bit dodgy. I don't quite know why. It was dodgy in Tomb Raider Anniversary, and it's still dodgy here. I don't quite know why they couldn't quite manage to sort it, but either way, that was a reasonably nice treasure. Thought it was going to be a little bit more difficult, but to be perfectly honest, it could have gone a hell of a lot worse, especially considering the times when I was very, very close to falling off. Because as you saw, I mean, I had to do a saving grab just on the end, because I just sort of just went off the side, well and truly, which is not good. Now, one thing I will point out is that Jan Mayen Island is basically your penultimate proper level. Because, as I said, level 6, which is in the Andaman Sea, is really not very long, and then after that we are on the final level of the game, which, I mean, is pretty damn awesome. And it just goes to show that the game is pretty short when you think about it. We've covered ground quite smoothly and quite quickly, even if I have gone ever so slightly mad at moments. Don't worry, it will get worse. And if you were thinking, there's not been nearly enough combat in this game, don't worry, it's ramping up quite dramatically. This level is where it arguably starts to get potentially quite difficult, because you are going to be introduced to a very, very annoying enemy. At least it's very annoying in the sense that it has quite a lot of health. There's easily a more annoying variant of this enemy, but thankfully Lara is never going to have to come across it. No, that's for a different time. And is actually in one of the DLCs, so that's something to be excited about. But we have another treasure to be getting here. And this fella, oh dear. Now, I don't know whether it's easiest to just... Oh no, you do have to drop down and jump that way. I was thinking maybe it's possible to do a running jump to get it. No, don't do that. That would be stupid. And I think I've just got a little bit too much of a daredevil streak. I mean, if anything, it's kind of the problem that this set of Tomb Raider games has, is that death doesn't really mean a whole lot. Because there's a very quick death animation. Normally, there's sometimes a slightly longer one. And you have a slight horrific scream from Lara, and then you're back at the last checkpoint. Which is absolutely fine. And while I certainly think that it's fine for the Crystal Dynamics to be wanting to make you not want to accidentally kill Lara, as they did in the reboot by making the deaths pretty gosh darn horrific. I mean, those things are brutal. Like, I get that, but I think the whole way death works in this game, it makes it very obvious that it's a video game. And to be perfectly honest, that's what I prefer in my Tomb Raider. I'm not a massive fan of... Well, I mean, it's kind of a thing in general with games. I very much like games that are aware that they are games. They don't have to announce it verbally in their narratives. I mean, that generally always ends up being rather clunky. But just an awareness that you are involved in an interactive medium, and it embraces that. So it doesn't... It accepts that death in games is a thing, so we don't have to make it ridiculously gory, we just have to make it kind of bad. It's slightly annoying so that you don't do it, but if it happens, it happens, and it doesn't get in the way too much. And this is what I was talking about. This thing's terrifying. And so, yes, we have to fight off against Yetis! Because I believe that's what these guys are called. And the reason they're annoying is because they're big, they have lots of health, and... Well, I mean, this one in particular, you're in a very small room. Although, having said that, this one's an idiot! Like, well and truly completely stupid. But he's dead. Now, obviously Yetis are ape-like, really, really large humanoid figures that inhabit the Himalayan region of Nepal and Tibet. Although, obviously, they're here in Valhalla for some bizarre reason. But, yes, what Lara was obviously referring to in saying these Yeti-like features might have inspired the frost giants from Norse mythology. Yeah, those are basically the Jotnar, or Jotun, or Jotun, or however you want to pronounce it. So they were banished, and they hate people, and there's generally a lot of opposition and competition and all sorts. Apparently, the kind of, well, the Jotun may have the same root as eat, so it might have meant man-eater, because it was really big. I'm pretty sure that, well, I mean, they're giants, and I'm pretty sure that they are the frost giants, but I'm not 100% sure, because there are also fire Jotsna, because they're fire, and they take control of stuff in Ragnarok, and they wreak the final, help wreak the final destruction. But I think we might have found Mjolnir. Oh yeah! Together, we will open the seals of Helheim and fulfill our destinies. And that's exactly what we're going to do right now by visiting the Andaman Sea. So the Andaman Sea is literally just west of Thailand and southeast of the Bay of Bengal, south of Burma, Myanmar, whatever you want to call it, and east of the Andaman Islands. And obviously this is basically because Amanda is trying to find out what the hell we were looking for and trying to get one over on us. It's not going to work. I can tell you that now. But we're going to kick her ass. I mean, we have Mjolnir. It's just going to be an absolute bloodbath, apart from there's not going to be any blood, but still. So, you can select to use Mjolnir as a weapon, just like you were able to use Excalibur, or at least the massive sword thing that we figured out was of the same make as Excalibur. And it is stupidly powerful. So you can do projectiles with it, you can smash things. It's amazing. And we will be using it to slaughter countless of Amanda's troops, which is just great. And whilst I am having a mess around and then going on to actually go kill people, I should probably bring up that when we got to Jan Mayen Island, Zip brought up the fact that Amanda's ship is called, or at least this version of the ship is called, the Tisiphone. Now, Tisiphone is the name of two figures in Greek mythology. The name literally means avenging murder. So, one of the Tisiphones is one of the Erinyes or Furies, which are very, very, very angry things. Basically, sort of harpy-looking, like women with wings, and very, very, very angry, trying to kill you constantly. And there's also Tisiphone, who's the daughter of Alcmaeon and Manto. And then she gets sold into slavery, but is eventually rescued. So, I'd say it's somewhat fitting for Amanda's second ship. It's kind of hilarious that it is basically identical to the first one. Nice way to reuse assets without actually having to put in any effort. Now, what's somewhat annoying is that Mjolnir does the same thing that Excalibur did all the way back in Tomb Raider Legend, is that Lara's movements are really, really bizarre when you use it. I wouldn't say it's quite as bad as the massive jump back that Lara did when she had Excalibur. I mean, that thing was huge in comparison to this. But Lara certainly has a lot of movement happening when she swings the hammer. And in the next level, that can potentially cause you problems. It really shouldn't cause you anything here, because there's nothing really to fall off of. But it could cause you grief later on. And really, after this point, the only weapon you should be using is Mjolnir. Because, I mean, seriously, no other weapons cause anywhere near as much damage. And just also, none of them are anywhere near this call. I mean, we're fighting with Thor's hammer. Come on, we're shooting lightning out of a hammer. And we're human. Like, I mean, come on. That's just ridiculous. Also, I mean, Lara's become incredibly bloodthirsty, but at least she's not saying anything and making me feel bad about killing these guys. But while I have, obviously, just quite a surprising amount of health, it's because, as I said, I'm incredibly reckless. There's something in Tomb Raider that does just bring out the recklessness in me. These guys aren't that difficult. I mean, especially the fact that you can kill them in one hit if you hit them. But it is just the getting the hit in that may or may not be your problem. The reason you kill them instantly is because, you know, you fling them off the end. Or at least fling them off the edge of the boat. Which, I mean, like, seriously, that is violent. You're sending these guys to a watery grave. Naughty Lara. But I believe that this is pretty much the last corner, and we are about to face down Natla and Amanda and give them a right seeing to with our massive hammer. Give them hell for killing Alistair and all that jazz, and also find out where the hell Avalon is in Helheim. Come on, Natla. Give us the info.
But before you put me to death, tell me, are you prepared to wait for Odin to appear and perform the ritual to open Helheim?
And do you know this ritual? Of course.
I'm sure you've realized that I want to get to Avalon just as much as you do. But neither of us can go alone. You need my ritual, and I need your hammer.
When you step out of line, you'll get it. You destroyed my home. You killed Alistair!
I got what I wanted. Isn't that all we care about?
Ah! get out of my sight.
Meet you there.